everyone, this is Optu from Pythonist. I hope you're doing well. Generators can help us to save a lot of memory. So in this video, we're going to understand how generators and iterators can help us to write efficient programs in the context of memory usage. So let's get started. When many people with experience in a native programming language start learning Python, they are taken aback by the difference in for loop notation. In other languages, we have to write a for loop as for, then we have to define and initialize a variable, a condition statement, and an increment statement. Then inside the curly braces, we can write our own logic. In Python, they are instead introduced to a new function called range or xrange. These two functions provide insight into the paradigm of programming using generators. But first of all, let's try to understand what they are and what's about the iterators. After that, we will write our own implementation for these functions to deeply understand the different concepts. So let's start with iterators. Iterators are everywhere in Python. They are elegantly implemented within for loops, comprehensions, and generators, etc., but hidden in plain sight. Iterator in Python is simply an object that can be iterated upon, an object which will return data one element at a time. Technically speaking, Python iterator object must implement two special methods, dunderiter and dunderNext, and collectively called the iterator protocol. An object is called iterable if we can get an iterator from it. Most of built-in containers in Python, like list, tuple, string, etc., are iterables. The iter function returns an iterator from them. Let's try to understand how iterating through an iterator works in Python with the help of an example. So for example, I have a list named as my underscore list with the following elements 4, 7, 0, and 3. We can get an iterator for this list by using the built-in function iter. Then we use the next function to manually iterate through all the items of an iterator. So if we call the next method to this list, it will return the very first value, which is 4. So when I have to get the value 7, once again I have to call this function. So during the previous call, the next function has been saved the context and the state of this function and pauses the execution. So this time when I call it once again, it will just resume that particular state and return the next value. But when it will reach to the last value, which is 3, it will raise an error that no items left. As you can notice that this is not an appropriate or a good way to iterate through a list. A more elegant way of automatically iterating is by using the for loop. Using this, we can iterate over any object that can return an iterator. For example, list, string, or file, etc. So iterate through this list using a for loop is very simple. We simply have to say for element in my underscore list, then inside this loop, we can simply print out our element. So this means that the for loop was able to iterate automatically through the list. In fact, the for loop can iterate over any iterable. Let's take a closer look at how the for loop is actually implemented in Python. So internally, the for loop creates an iterator object by calling iter method on the iterable. And this for loop is actually an infinite while loop. And inside the loop, it calls the next method to get the next element and execute the body of the for loop with this value. After all the items exhaust, stop iteration is erased, which is internally cat and loop ends. Note that any other kind of exception will pass through. Okay, that's great. Now let's try to implement our own iterator in Python. Building an iterator from scratch is easy in Python. We just have to implement the methods like dunderiter and dunderNext. The dunderiter method returns the iterator object itself. If required, some initialization can be performed. The dunderNext method must return the next item in the sequence. On reaching the end and in subsequent calls, it must raise stop iteration. So I'll define a class as myiter And inside this class, I'll define three different functions: dunderInit, dunderIter, and dunderNext. And inside the dunderInit method, I will initialize the max variable for maximum iterations. And then inside the dunderIter method, I will define an iterator and return that particular iterator. And then in the dunderNext method, we have to check that if the iteration is inside the maximum boundary, and then we can take its power of 2 and return that value. And in the either case, we can raise the stop iteration exception. To utilize this class, we have to create its instance and pass a number for maximum iteration. Then we can simply iterate through it by using a for loop, and inside that for loop, we will print the result. That's it, how an iterator implemented in Python. Let's talk about the generators. At this stage, you know that there is a lot of overhead in building an iterator in Python. We have to implement the class with dunderIter and dunderNext method, keep track of internal states, and raise stop iteration when there was no values to be returned, etc. This is both lengthy and counterintuitive. Generator comes into rescue in such situations. Python generators are a simple way of creating iterators. All the overhead we mentioned during the iterators are automatically handled by generators in Python. Simply speaking, a generator is a function that returns an object which can iterate over one value at a time. It is fairly simple to create a generator in Python. It is as easy as defining a normal function with yield statement instead of a return statement. If a function contains at least one yield statement, it becomes a generator function. Both yield and return will return some value from a function. The difference is that while a return statement terminates a function entirely, yield statement pauses the function, saving all its states, and later continues from there on successive calls. Okay, let's write some code and define a simple generator function. So I will define a function named as my_gen. And inside that function, I will initialize the variable n with 1 and print out the first statement as this is printed first and return that on the first function call by using the yield. Then I will increment the n variable and once again print that this is printed second and return it as a yield statement. And then once again, I will increment it and print as this is printed at last and return that using yield. And if we iterate through this function, it will just print out all of these statements one by one. So this is how generators works in Python. Okay, now let's try to write our own implementations of range and xrange functions. So I will define a function named as range, which will take start, stop, and step. Then inside this function, I will define a list as numbers and write a while loop as while start less than stop. Then inside this loop, I will append the start element to the numbers list and increment it with the help of the step. And finally, I will return numbers. And in the case of xrange function, I will define the function in the same way. But inside the while loop, I will yield the start by returning the start value first. Then I will increment it with the help of the step. Okay, we can iterate through both of these functions with the help of a while loop. The first thing to note is that the range implementation must pre-create the list of all numbers within the range. So if the range is from 1 to 10,000, the function will do 10,000 appends to the numbers list and then return it. On the other hand, the generator is able to return many values. Every time the code gets to the yield, the function emits its value. And when another value is requested, the function resumes running and emits the new value. When the function reaches its end, a stop iteration exception is thrown, indicating that the given generator has no more values. As a result, even though both functions must in the end do the same number of calculations, the range version of the preceding loop uses 10 times more memory as compared to the xrange implementation. With this code in mind, we can decompose the for loops that use our implementations of range and xrange. In Python, for loop requires that the object we are looping over supports iteration. This means that we must be able to create an iterator out of the object we want to loop over. To create an iterator from almost any object, we can simply use Python's built-in iter function. This function for lists, tuples, dictionaries, and sets returns an iterator over the items or keys in the object. For more complex objects, iter returns the result of dender iter property of the object. Since xrange already returns an iterator, calling iter on it is a trivial operation and it simply returns the original object. However, since the range returns a list, we must create a new object, a list iterator, that will iterate over all the values in the list. Once an iterator is created, we simply call the next function on it, retrieving new values until a stop iteration exception is thrown. Okay, let's come to the point to explore the generators in the context of code optimization. As touched on previously, the way we get the memory benefits with a generator is by dealing only with the current values of interest. At any point in our calculation, with the generator, we only have the current value and cannot reference any other items in the sequence. This can sometimes make generator more difficult to use, but there are many modules and functions that can help. The main library of interest is iterTools in the standard library. It supplies generator versions of Python's built-in functions like map, reduce, filter, and zip, in addition to many other useful functions. Of particular note here is slice, allows slicing a potentially infinite generator. Chains together multiple generators, take while, adds a condition that will end a generator, and cycle, makes a finite generator infinite by constantly repeating it. Okay, by wrapping it up, we are able to process much more data than could fit into memory with the help of iterators and generators. We are able to do faster than if we had used lists, since we avoid all the costly append operations. Since iterators are a primitive type in Python, these should always be a go-to method for trying to reduce the memory footprint of an application. The benefits are that results are lazily evaluated, so you only ever process the data you need, and memory is saved since we don't store previous results unless explicitly required to. In later videos, I'll talk about other methods that can be used for more specific problems and introduce some new ways of looking at problems when RAM is an issue. Another benefit of solving problems using iterators is that it prepares your code to be used on multiple CPUs or multiple computers, as we will discuss more about this thing in the later videos. When working with iterators, you must always think about the various states that are necessary for your algorithm to work. Once you figure out how to package the state necessary for the algorithm to run, it doesn't matter where it runs. We can see this sort of paradigms, for example, with the multiprocessing and IPython modules, both of which use a map-like function to launch parallel tasks. This is a very short discussion about generators and iterations and their working behind the scene. So it's a much more complex task to implement the generators for specific problems, but in the future videos, I will just guide you through with the help of different scenarios. So if you like this video, be sure to subscribe to my channel and hit the bell icon so you will never miss a fantastic video in the future. Thanks for watching.